Good afternoon. Happy Father's Day to everybody that like to come out. I hope you're doing what you want. Doing what I wanted to do on Father's Day. We welcome Jeff Leich. He's the, executive director of the New England Ski Museum, which is in Franconia. And he's written two books, Over the Headwall, the Ski History of Tuckerman's Ravine, and Tales of the Tenth, Mountain Troops and American Skiing, which he's going to address today, which looks really good on the slideshow. This topic is very appropriate for us, because most of you know the Cram family were very involved in skiing, the Olympics and the 10th Mountain, and they learned to ski right on this little hill. They lived right across the street. So this is great to have him come and tell us more about what we thought we knew, but we really didn't. So thank you very much for coming.
Well, I just learned that Wendy Cram grew up right at the catty corner across the street here, so that's kind of thrilling. Of course, he's well known in the 10th Mountain Division world, and a lot of these ski towns in the 40s sent a lot of people to the 10th Mountain Division, which was the first U.S. Army unit ever recruited to be a mountain division, and a lot of interesting things about it, and we'll get there, but want to first thank the Denver Public Library, which has a great archive of photos and archives of the 10th Mountain Division, and also the Harvard Business School and the Holocaust Museum, who all contributed some images to this slideshow. This is New England Ski. Maybe we should turn the lights down a little bit, or. New England Ski Museum has been in Franconia Notch, New Hampshire since 1982. It's a former vehicle maintenance garage for Cannon Mountain, and as such, we're pretty limited. But there are ski museums other places, most notably Stowe in Vermont, and Kingfield and Bethel in Maine, and a few out west. But we like to think that our unique proposition at the New England Ski Museum is that we put a new exhibit up on some aspect of ski history every year that's up there for a year, and then we over the course of that year gradually publish the content of that exhibit in our member journal, and that's the derivation of this exhibit that we had up last year, and these three journals here, if you care to take one, have the content in it about the 10th Mountain Division. We have a membership of about 1,500 people around the world. I think we're in 11 countries and 36 or 37 states. Membership is $35, so if there's any interest in that, we'd love to have you, but I don't want to pitch that to you guys. We are on the verge of getting a second location in New Hampshire up and running in North Conway, downtown North Conway. This is an artist's sketch of how that may look. It's the former community center building here that has become vacant when the community center built a new facility about a year ago. So with any luck, by the end of the year, we're going to have a location there. Very fitting location because the community center was conceived and funded by Harvey Dow Gibson, the North Conway local who started Cranmore and got a lot of skiing started in the valley, and also because it's the this is the train station where Hannes Schneider, if you know that name, the great ski instructor from Austria, when he was ejected from Europe, arrived in 1939 to teach at Cranmore. How much time do we have? 45 minutes. I'm going to gloss over some of these early parts about predecessors of military skiing. There is an article in one of these journal issues about European mountain troops, ski troops, if you're interested. But suffice it to say that skiing is a very old, long before it was a sport, it was a human pursuit, a way to get around on skis in deep snow. People, as suggested here, use it for hunting, very effective to hunt hooved animals on deep snowpack on skis when the animals plunged into the snowpack and the skiers floated over. And it probably pretty quickly became an instrument of warfare as well. the 10th Mountain Division was actually not the first American military unit on skis. There were small detachments of cavalrymen in the late 1800s who were assigned to Yellowstone National Park when it was brand new to patrol Yellowstone on skis to try to control the poaching that was going on. But it was a very, very small detachment. Europeans had mountain troops in the about the 1870s on. And in World War I, there was a lot of, on the southern front, the Dolomite front between Austria and Italy. At the end of the war, there were huge battles between opposing mountain troops, the Italian Alpini and the Austrians. There's still scars, lots of scars on those mountains because of the intensity of what happened on the Western Front. It sort of was ignored and was definitely not the main story, but it was there were big battles in the mountains. Avalanches were started with artillery that wiped out troops, and there was a lot of engineering, as you can see from some of these photos. But really, our story starts with when Russia invaded Finland in the fall of 1939 and into the winter of 1940. Skiing in the 1930s, alpine skiing had gotten very popular, especially in places like Woodstock and Bridgewater, North Conway, Franconia, Stowe. It had developed from an obscure little pastime in the 1930s to a major sports fad and economic activity by the time the war started in 1941 for us. But so as these skiers were observing what was happening in Finland and where guerrilla troops of the Finns, operating mainly on skis and on snowshoes, managed to hold off mechanized Russian columns of armor for 3 months. They observed this. Ultimately, the Finns had to sue for peace. But the skiers, a few skiers here, noticed this and asked the question to themselves: well, what would happen if we get into the war, and B, if there is if there's an invasion of North America in the winter? How well equipped are our troops to fight in the winter in the snow? And the answer was not at all. You know, the U.S. Army at that point was a warm weather operation. And up in near Bromley in Manchester, a couple of three or four friends were gathered around the fire in 1940 after a ski race up there, and said, you know, mulled this around and said, well, maybe we should offer the services of the National Ski Association, the sort of the organizing body that's now USSA of the sport. Let's see if the NSA can do anything to help the War Department in developing winter troops. And the one name that comes up all the time when this comes about is Minnie Dole. Charles Minot Dole, seen here, was the founder of the National Ski Patrol, which started in 1938. And he was an insurance executive working in New York. Never a great skier, but he was a great organizer, and he had a first-rate personality for getting to know people and convincing, bringing them together to do some big project. So within 2 or 3 years, really, the National Ski Patrol went from nothing to being a nationwide organization to help skiers that needed first aid on the hill. And Dole got behind the idea of trying to convince the War Department that they needed some form of ski troops, was the thought at the time. Along with Dole at that conversation, up in Manchester was Bob Livermore, who was an Olympic skier, had gone to the 1936 Olympics, which was the first one to have alpine skis, and Alec Bright, Massachusetts. Both these guys were from Massachusetts. Bright had convinced the state of New Hampshire that it would be a great idea to install an aerial tramway at Cannon Mountain, and after a couple of 3 years of trying, that actually came about. Also, at part of that conversation was Roger Langley, seen here, who's the president of the National Ski Association. And they were rebuffed for almost 2 years throughout the various bureaucratic maneuvers that they tried. The also involved was the American Alpine Club, which was a much smaller group than the National Ski Patrol, but also were aware of the capabilities of mountain troops in Europe from having seen there, having climbed there, and again thinking, you know, what if we get drawn into the war and the war is in the mountains, the war is in snow-covered country. So the Alpine Club was very important as well. And here, finally, a meeting between Dole and his associate John E.P. Morgan and Langley and Colonel Hurtis and Colonel Walker, who were sort of the first two military men really assigned to work with this, what was probably seen as a pretty oddball group at first, to explore the idea of developing some kind of a winter and mountain warfare capability. This is a lousy scan out of a Camp Hale newspaper from 1944, but I put it in here because it shows General Philipson here. And General Philipson was the first military brass that Minnie Dole approached to convince him, you know, to try to make this a reality. And Philipson had been in charge of Camp Pine, which is where today's 10th Mountain Division trains at Watertown, New York. So Philipson knew, A, how cold it can get up there, and B, how lousily equipped the American Army was. They really didn't have any kind of winter gear. And so Philipson was important in that he encouraged Dole, but really couldn't do much with the War Department. And then a 1944 photo of Colonel Harry Twaddle, if you can believe the last name, who was at the time of the Dole was agitating, was the acting assistant chief of staff of the Army. And Twaddle was very supportive as well, and drew in the American Alpine Club. This is at the end of the war when he's interviewing a German von Papen, who has just been captured by Twaddle's division. There were a lot of frustrations for Dole and his group, but the upshot was that in the fall of 1940 and into the winter of 1941, at least all the divisions of the Army were not sent to southern bases to sit out the winter. At six different locations in the northern tier of the U.S., small patrols, ski patrols they were called, from the various divisions were went out and bought civilian ski equipment and experimented with skis. And this is a photo from one of those out near Mount Rainier. So winter of 1941, here's the one of those small ski patrols. They actually traversed the Olympic Mountains in the Olympic Peninsula on skis from west to east. And the major lesson learned was, if the Army is going to do this, the Army needs to develop the winter and mountain equipment, because everything that you could buy off the shelf comes from Europe and is not available now because the war is on over there. So the quartermaster general appointed this man. His name is George Dorio. He was a Harvard Business School professor. He became the head of a group in the quartermaster's office who was developing mountain and winter equipment. Apparently a brilliant man. After the war, he was the first to really develop a venture capital fund. And I don't know anything about that, but the people that worked with him, a lot of them drawn from the Alpine Club, thought highly of him. This is an expedition, a U.S. Army test expedition to Mount McKinley in Alaska in the summer of 1942 to start testing some of this equipment that was rapidly coming through the pipeline. Among the people here that are notable are Bob Bates, Bradford Washburn, and Al Jackman. Washburn was involved, but not really too much. He was testing gear for the Air Force. Bates was in the quartermaster office and developed things like boots and sweaters and various things. And Jackman was one of the first, career Army people assigned to the 10th Mountain, to what became the 10th Mountain Division. Here's Jackman and Walter Wood of the Alpine Club in Alaska. They're tying up skis and getting ready to airdrop them onto glaciers to see, you know, how you can supply troops. That expedition did summit on McKinley, and here you see coming down from the summit of McKinley. Adams Carter, Harvard student, was another one really involved with the Quartermaster Corps. He was hired at first to translate all the European mountain troop manuals into English, and then became very helpful in developing the mountain boot that we'll see in a minute. So sometime in 1941, you know, someone in the Army made the decision that they were going to go into this in a big way, and they bought up just about all the entire product of the American ski manufacturing business in 1941. This is a meeting with Carl Lund of Northland and the Northland plant, and buying skis similar to the ones that just came in the door out there. I bet if we look at those, there'll be a stamp on them that tell us which manufacturer it was. The mountain boot, you know, one of the problems in having that's still a problem when you are ski mountaineering is having a boot that's suitable for skiing and also suitable for climbing and mountaineering, and this was their best approximation of it. It had a very very wide opening here, so a lot of socks could be worn, and it had these what was then a very new form of rubber sole that a few of the people in the quartermaster office had been aware of. It was developed in Italy by a bootmaker named Vitali Bramani. But then the war came and no one could get into Italy to get these, get a sample of these boots and the new soles that were much better than hobnailed boots, which was what was being used at the point, until one day, Adams Carter and some of his friends were up at Pinkham Notch Camp at the base of Mount Washington, and they found someone in there walking around in a pair of boots with these new rubber soles. So they did whatever they had to do to at least borrow those boots from that climber and sent them down and reverse engineered the rubber sole. And of course, we all know this as the Vibram sole, Vitali Bramani, you know, a shortening of the name. But that rubber sole was, you know, it was brand new and very effective. And then at the same time, the Air Force and all the services were looking to buy the limited stock of shearling that was available in the United States. And these guys in the Quartermaster came up with the a synthetic pile jacket liner so that they wouldn't need all the shearling and let all the Air Force and the Navy have it all. You know, sort of the beginning of the synthetic pile jackets that we wear a lot. And, you know, years later, Carol Reedshop in North Conway got a hold of all these surplus items and added a zipper and somehow made them fashionable until for about 5 or 10 years. But so there was a big effort to develop the equipment. In 1942, a detachment was sent to the Columbia Ice Field to build a road up onto the ice field so that Studebaker could bring their snowcats up and test those. And the end result was the Weasel, which was used, you know, went into production, was used a lot in the snow for the 10th, but also became very useful in the Pacific as an amphibious vehicle. So I can't tell you when exactly the decision was made, probably in October of 1941, September of 1941, to activate a regiment, a battalion of a mountain regiment at Fort Lewis, Washington. And it was November 15th, 1941 that was activated. And the National Ski Patrol, who had been agitating all this time to have these mountain troops, was tasked with recruiting people who were skiers, who were mountaineers, who were backwoods people to join this. And that was just very unusual because no civilian agency has ever had a contract to be a recruiting agent for the military before. But the Ski Patrol came up with a questionnaire that they distributed in ski magazines and to their members. And people seeing the writing on the wall that there was probably a war coming, joined up. And of course, 3 weeks later, Pearl Harbor came about and there was the war. But Fort Lewis was within sight of Mount Rainier. So when they got going, their commanding officer arranged for them to train at Mount Rainier State National Park for the winter of 1942. One of the first of the National Ski Patrol recruits to arrive at Fort Lewis was Charles McLean here, who had just graduated from Dartmouth. He got out to wrote a kind of a humorous account of getting out to Fort Lewis, and no one knew what the mountain troops were, where he should go to bunk, who they were. But within days and weeks, it filled in. And the commanding officer was Onslow Rolfe, who was born in Wolfboro, New Hampshire, but moved out of the state pretty much right away. Career Army cavalryman, knew nothing about skiing, which would be the case pretty much with all the commanding officers and all the brass in the 10th throughout the war. But people took to him. As a cavalryman, I don't know if you can read it, it says 87th Infantry Mountain Regiment, through these portals pass the most beautiful mules in the world. You know, the idea is this is a unit that's going to be, this is not a mechanized unit. This is going to operate away from the roads. How are they going to carry all their gear? And the answer was mule packers. So as time went on, you had this odd mix of skiers who were mostly college graduates or had some college because that's where the skiing was, and Texas and Arkansas mule skinners, and mixing together in the Army and learning each other's technologies. Didn't always work out. But here they are at just about ready to leave Mount Rainier in the summer of 42, or the spring of 42. Wasn't clear where they were going. They went back to Fort Lewis and did things like practice rock climbing on climbing walls that they made out of logs and gravel pits. But the Army had made the decision that they were going to build a military base that would accommodate at least a division, 15,000 or 20,000 men, somewhere in the American West, and tasked Bob Monahan, who was with the Forest Service at that point, but after the war was the Dartmouth College Forester. Monahan and a few others selected a few sites, and the first one they selected was here at Henry's Lake near Yellowstone National Park. They, in the fall of 1942, there were big construction projects going on. The local schools were hiring up teachers because they expected there was going to be a military base of 15,000 people around. They were figuring out how to plow the snow. It's a very snowy area. And all of a sudden, the plug was pulled on that. And it turned out that Henry's Lake is, there's a apparently a trumpeter swan flyway that goes right over the site of this proposed military base between Henry's Lake and Yellowstone somewhere, and a relative, probably an uncle of FDR, was active in the Conservation Society, who was trying to protect the trumpeter swan. So the upshot was, and these remnants still exist there at Henry's Lake, right across from a gas station. You know, so there would have been a huge flat plain going down to the lake that you can see down here, and you know the trumpeter swans are over here somewhere. But that plug got pulled, and the construction began at a site that became Camp Hale very near Leadville, sort of halfway between Leadville and the site of today's Vail. Vail did not exist then. Big flat valley, had a mainline railroad going through it, had plenty of power, had a U.S. highway, 8 or 10 miles from Vail, which was kind of a dying mine. Well, it was a mining town. And in the summer of 42 and the fall of 42, while, you know, recruits are coming in and they're expanding the number of regiments all the time, Camp Hale was being built. So there were the 87th Mountain Infantry Regiment was the first of three regiments that made up the 10th Mountain Division. The 87th, you know, is the oldest, had some of the most experienced skiers and climbers. And as Camp Hale was being built, detachments of these, you know, skilled mountaineers were being sent out to train other standard infantry divisions. They went all over, Wisconsin, you name it, they went there. The only place in the east they went was here at Lincoln, New Hampshire. And when in the fall of 1942, a detachment of about 20 or 30 men and officers spent about a month in Lincoln. And they went up into Franconia Notch, I think it was the 36th Infantry Division, they were training elements of that, and taught them how to you know, walk and hike on rough terrain on the Talus Field underneath the Cannon Mountain and the Old Man of the Mountains. And they did ambushes, you know, staged ambushes on the trails going up to Greenleaf Hut, and you know, had a pretty full day of it. And then down here in the Lincoln Hotel after dinner, they were given lessons in Norwegian language. And this went on for about a month. They were called back. They went to Camp Hale, and you know, pretty much all of them mostly forgot about that experience. But there's a very intriguing footnote in one of the histories of the official military histories of the 10th that says this Lincoln detachment was not really to train the whatever division it was, but it was a disinformation operation. They didn't use that word. Intelligence operation to convince the Germans that an invasion of Norway was imminent. And this footnote goes on to say it must have succeeded because a number of German divisions were pulled out of North Africa and sent to Norway on the verge of the American invasion of North Africa. So I don't know anything more about that, but it's a very interesting story. Lincoln was a mill town. And somehow did word leak out of there about these Norwegian lessons. No one really knows. But here's Camp Hale, finished in, just barely finished for the winter of 42-43. 500 buildings, all with coal-fired furnaces, you know, field houses, everything a military base needed. And you know, recruits are coming in. It was a smoggy valley. You can see the main line of the railroad here, and kind of some, you know, a coal-burning locomotive has just gone by. The air quality was terrible. People developed a cough. It was at 8 or 9,000 feet of elevation, and they trained much higher, so it was physically demanding, and not all the soldiers made it through Camp Hale. A lot of them transferred out to other units. But they did develop their own little training ski area. You can see a T-bar here at, they called it Cooper Hill. It's still open today, a Ski Cooper near Leadville. Nice little area. And they trained skiers here, but also down at Camp Hale, which was about 5 or 6 miles down the road. There's that T-bar. Leadville was had a pretty healthy red light district, so the men were restricted to camp for about the first year or so, and so they had to make their own recreation. You know, here was a quartet, and one of our museum members, Dick Calvert, here is one of these members. He lives in Wolfboro, New Hampshire, and one of the last of the 10th Mountain guys skiing that we're aware of. Experimentation with, you know, transportation and equipment continued. They tried dog sleds. They got, they learned how to pack mules. it's hard, you can't really see here, there were small little pack artillery howitzers, 75 millimeters, that could be taken apart and loaded on, each gun could be loaded on five or six mules. So there were something like 5,000 mules on the table of organization of the 10th Mountain Division when it got up to full speed. They brought in Arctic explorers to show how to dig igloos. I don't know that they ever used igloos much. And they had some of the best skiers in the world as ski instructors. This is Peter Gabriel, who is a Swiss mountaineer, Swiss mountain guide. Friedel Pfeiffer and Walter Prager. Walter Prager was the Dartmouth College ski coach at the time. But before he was the ski coach, he was one of the best ski racers in Europe and won very prestigious races over there. Friedel Pfeiffer was out of St. Anton, Austria, was one of Hannes Schneider's top instructors. So there was this huge conglomeration of talent in the ranks. They were sergeants. They were all non-coms. Torger Tokel here was the world champion ski jumper. And so they were walking around Camp Hale. People didn't know who they were going to meet that they'd, you know, seen in the headlines and cut clippings out for their scrapbooks as youths. Winston Pope, who was a famed photographer of the Mount Washington area, was on hand for the Signal Corps as the photographer, and a lot of these Camp Hale photos are Winston Pope's, like this one. I think we're pretty sure this is Winston Pope himself skiing this expanse of snowfields on Homestake Peak outside of Leadville near Camp Hale. Just an unbelievable picture to me of you just don't see powder slopes like that every day. Here's a picture of Homestake Peak with someone's drawn their route zigzagging up, how they climbed it on skis. Actually belonged, the mark was made by Francis Limmer, who was one of the famous Limmer bootmaking family in Intervale, was in the 10th. And a lot of training was done at Homestead Peak. This next photo was taken right about over here, where they used their pack artillery to shoot and bring down a huge avalanche. Sort of, no one really knew if that could be effective in the American Army, and you can judging by the size of some of these blocks that are probably part of the lake ice that got pushed up. It was very, very effective. But there wasn't a lot of knowledge of avalanche hazard, how to avoid avalanches, at least in the upper ranks. People like those, like Prager and Friedel Pfeiffer certainly knew that. Aspen wasn't too far away. Aspen at that point was a really a dying silver town, but there had been some attempts to, there had been a ski trail cut in the late 30s, the Roche Run, that's right there. So a lot of the troops went to Aspen when they could on their weekend leaves. The Jerome Hotel became famous for them. They'd stay there. They'd have races on the Roche Run. This is Steve Knowlton, who was a University of New Hampshire ski race star. The detachments kept going out and training. One big site was Seneca Rock, West Virginia, where many different standard infantry divisions came through and were trained by elements of the 10th, Peter Gabriel being one of them. They teach them how to, they'd be looking for the scouts of each division who would be expected to go up into church steeples and up to the high points and to be able to observe, and they gave them some basic mountaineering skills, and maybe this looked a little beyond basic here, but it's they put a lot of people through here. And then in the in 1943, of course, the Japanese had invaded some of the Aleutian Islands. And the 87th Mountain Regiment, along with a lot of other units were sent to invade the island of Kiska. This is Kiska Harbor. They were expecting a fight. Somehow the Japanese had, the very foggy area, had given the U.S. Navy the slip on, you know, so the invasion force really had no enemy, but it took them weeks to find that out, and in the process there were a couple of unfortunate incidents where there were some units fired on each other and there was some friendly fire casualty, the first casualties of the 10th. But you know, it was a cold and windy spot. You can see how they'd have to dig their tents into the tundra, and there were, the 87th was there until October or November of 43. This man right here is Brad Boynton, who was one of the founders of the Jackson Ski Touring Center over in New Hampshire. And so 1943 to 1944, that winter training continued at Camp Hale. A lot of the soldiers were getting impatient because the standard infantry divisions were trained in a matter of months and were already fighting overseas somewhere. And these guys were still at Camp Hale. Quite a few of them transferred to other units, a significant portion of them, because of the high number of college graduates, found their way to the OSS, the precursor of the CIA. But in the winter of 44, they had divisional maneuvers called D-Series, where the entire division went out for 2 and 3 weeks into the Colorado high country, and stayed out camping and having war games, and it was a brutal experience. Apparently, it snowed all the time. It was record cold temperatures, and people were heard to say, when they were under fire in Italy, saying, "Well, if it gets any worse, this is going to be as bad as D Series was." But you know, they've made a little block cabin here. But D-Series was rugged, but at the same time, they had, you know, the people that went, that made it through these two winters of training were in terrific physical condition from having been at training at elevation. And then all of a sudden, and at the same time, the Army really didn't know what to do with them. They had this huge table of organization, you know, they had no mechanized equipment. No commander wanted to be responsible for 5,000 mules and all this kind of thing. And they were looked at maybe as a little bit of a prima donna unit. So the Army decided, well, let's just turn them into a regular division. And in the summer of 44, they were sent to Camp Swift, Texas, right here near Austin, and spent the entire summer and fall of 44 in the hot Southwest. And for people that had signed up to be in Arctic and mountain environments, it was demoralizing. They didn't know what they were doing. At the same time, when they were done with this, they could march 25 miles in 8 hours in the desert heat. So it was another kind of hardening off process. And then in the fall, three things happened pretty much right away. They got a new commander, a new commanding officer named Hayes here. General Hayes was a Medal of Honor winner in World War I and had been in France with a different division. And they had long since been designated the 10th Division, but now they were designated the 10th Mountain Division, and they got a little rocker. You can't see it on George Hayes's shoulder here, but that said Mountain, that made them all very proud. And then they had orders to embark for Italy in November of 44, and they were really the last unit to go to war in the Army. And when they got to Italy, they were fortunate to see Debbie Bankart, who was the Red Cross donut lady. Debbie Bankart had been a fixture of the ski school at Franconia and at Hanover, had actually been on a lot of the recruiting tours trying to get people to join the mountain troops. So it was interesting to see Debbie there. She married a 10th officer named Eddie, Captain Eddie. And this was the situation when they got to what was called the winter line here. the stalemated in Italy, you know, through the Apennine Mountains ran here. And the Germans had so far fought off Allied attempts to break through. The initial idea by Mark Clark, the theater commander, was to, you know, to go from Florence right up Route 65. And Lucian Truscott, who was in command of the 10th over General Hayes, said, well, wait, we've got these mountain troops. Let's try Highway 64. It's the terrain is ruggeder. It's not as well defended. It's been tried before, but let's try it again. So that was the idea, that they were going to try Route 64. And when they got to Italy, when finally all three divisions were there by sometime in January of 1945, the hills were snow-covered. There were, you know, a foot or two of snow on them. They didn't have their ski equipment. Their gear, for the most part, was left behind. They did perform a few ski patrols here and there, but really nothing significant compared to what they trained for. But they were in a mountain environment, and they turned out to be very effective there. I'm going to gloss over the combat history if you don't mind, but the first battle that they fought is the one that everybody remembers and knows them for, called Riva Ridge. And this is a picture of Riva Ridge a couple of days after the 10th took it. This was the escarpment that was facing the 10th from their position. And along the top here, there were four, five, six different summits on this high ridge where there were German artillery observers posted. And the backside of this, we'll see in the next photo, is a gently sloping slope going down to the German terrain. The Germans apparently didn't think anybody could attack up this cliff. And over the course of two or three weeks, the 10th sent out night patrols to try to find some routes up here. They ended up finding five routes that were feasible, and they fixed ropes on two of them. The others they didn't need to. And on the night of February 19th to 20th, about 900 men of the 86th Regiment actually climbed up here in the dark, stayed quiet, and took those artillery posts. Here's a better shot of the escarpment they climbed, and then the summit here as it gently slopes down. After the war, somebody said, well, you know, if it had been at Mad River Glen, they would have been skiing these things we climbed up. But I don't know how true that is. But a contemporary sketch of there was still some snow climbing up Riva Ridge, and a photograph of the summit after they've taken some of the outposts. You know, you can see these various summits where looking off to your right was the main objective, the first main objective of the 10th, called the Mount Belvedere Gorgolesco Ridge. So they took that one night. There were counterattacks for three or four nights, but they held on to it and enabled the main attack to proceed the next day on Belvedere. Here's a group going up Belvedere, and you can see Riva Ridge back here, and can imagine how devastating it would be to have observers up here calling in artillery strikes on these soldiers. Nevertheless, even without that, some of the artillery was pre-sighted. There were landmines. There were defensive positions all along here, and the 4 or 5 day Belvedere offensive took about 900 lives from the 10th. There was a short pause in early March around the town of Castile Delano. They ended up taking this entire ridge that was in question, and then again in early April there was a pause. And in April 14th, the spring offensive began all along the line, not just the 10th. And this was the April 14th, the day they jumped off, was the one with the most casualties of the one day. Bob Dole, who ran for president a few years ago, was wounded in this sector on that day, April 14th. So they took a lot of casualties then, but the Germans were, you know, demoralized. They were in retreat. The 10th got an armored division associated with them, pushed out of the mountains down into the plains of the Po River Valley, across the Po here. You can see some of the first assault boats going across. And then a you can actually see, this is General Hayes, General George Hayes right here, watching the, you know, after a day or so, they've gotten a pontoon bridge up over the Po. And they, so they, you know, they got out of the mountains here, pushed across the Po, up north to Verona, and then the idea was they were, the German troops that were in Italy were retreating at this point, April and early May of 1945. There'd been this concept that the Germans were all going to gather in an Alpine redoubt in the mountains of Austria and hold out as bitter enders. And so the 10th was sent to block up here to block the passes going back. It never came to that, but they went along the east side of Lake Garda here, had some terrific artillery barrages in a series of seven or eight tunnels along the lake there, and there were battles there in the very closing days of the war. General, they had amphibious boats. Here's General Hayes going over to check out Mussolini's villa, where Mussolini had been put, you know, was staying. It's not exactly clear to me whether he was is there of his own will or not, but, you know, he'd sort of been deposed by that point. Hayes got over there and found that Mussolini had fled and was probably already dead by that point. But the German surrender in Italy came a few days before Germany. I think it was May 2nd. And I think this is the town of Riva at the head of the of Lake Garda, where you know, the townspeople are out celebrating. The German opponent, General von Senger here on the left, on surrendering the German troops in Italy, insisted on that he wanted to surrender to General Hayes. So they went. Hayes drove him down to headquarters. Wherever it was, they signed the surrender documents. And, you know, the post they were in Italy all summer. There was, you know, they found a champagne warehouse in Riva, I think. And some of them were sent up to the Yugoslav border, where there was a sort of a peacekeeping mission. Might have been unclear if Tito, who was on the scene at that point, might have been getting aggressive, but basically they spent most of the summer in northern Italy, could relax a little bit. They skied in the mountains, and then on their way back, they shipped out in I guess early August of 45, knowing that they would come back, have a furlough for 30 days, and then be one of the first units to as the last to leave the country. One of the first pegged for the invasion of Japan, of the home islands. But while they're on the boat, the two bombs were dropped and peace was declared. So they went, I think they had a furlough, they had their furlough and went back to Colorado in November and were all mustered out, pretty much all of them. And by the time they'd gotten back there, Camp Hale had been torn down and looked like this. And there is a story out there that there were two Camp Hales, two military bases called Camp Hale. And this was the one they did not want to tear down, but I don't know how true that is. But the reason the Ski Museum is interested in this whole story is because of the things that a lot of the 10th Mountain veterans did after the war. So with the caveat that there were thousands of 10th Mountain veterans, something like 20,000 men went through it. You know, and thousands became instrumental in the after the war in skiing and in hiking and mountaineering. Just a very few of the highlights here. This is Monty Atwater with a cigarette dangling out of his mouth. Monty Atwater became sort of the the father of avalanche control technology in the United States. He was hired as a snow ranger at Alta, Utah, right after the war. Alta, if you know, has a big avalanche problem, and they really, before he got there, all they could do was close it at times when the avalanche hazard was high. But he figured out how to throw explosive hand charges, how to he had artillery at his hand, and how to use artillery to control avalanches. And this photo, he's at the getting ready for the 1960 Winter Olympics at Squaw Valley, California, where he ran the avalanche control. Fred Becky was, I should mention that one of there were two units. One was called 10th Recon or Reconnaissance, and one was called the Mountain Training Group. And they were the ones that mostly went to these other, that trained these other divisions. Wendell Cram was in one of those, 10th or Recon or MTC. And so a lot of these people ended up, were in that as well, including Fred Becky. Fred Becky was a climber. He's a German immigrant, and you know, as a child, his parents brought him here. He's probably put up more first ascents in North America than anyone alive, and has written great books about him. And a few years ago, he was still climbing at age 90 or so. David Brower became the head of the Friends of the Earth and the Sierra Club, and actually kind of a ski area critic, you know, a ski area development, but he was a 10th Mountain Division man. There he is with President Johnson. Larry Jump, with his wife Marnie, opened up right after the war, was sent to study some sites by the Forest Service in Colorado of where it would make good ski areas, and stumbled on this place, Arapaho Basin, which is now a major area. You can see right here the lifts that were put in during Larry Jump's time, but now it extends over the Montezuma Ridge here and down below. Probably one of the first ski areas developed in Colorado after the war. One of the pieces of equipment that wasn't so successful in the 10th was the two-man army tent right here. Was pretty much hated by everybody that had to use it because it was totally waterproof. And people would, two men sleeping in here at night would wake up in the morning with the condensation frozen on, you know, and so there was 4 or 5 inches of ice that came off, and no one really wanted to sleep here, but in these, and often they would dig snow caves instead. But the after the war, Jerry Cunningham, one of the 10th Mountain Division, I don't know if he was in MTG, he may have been, started Jerry Mountain Equipment at a time when the backpacking boom was hitting. And you can see that the Jerry tents, you know, are really look a lot like those two mountain tents, but they didn't have the condensation problem. Here's Paul Petzold at Camp Hale. Paul Petzold was was a very famous mountaineer at this time, in the because he'd been on an expedition to K2 and gotten up to 26,000 feet without oxygen, along with the expedition leader, and no one had climbed that high at that point. So when someone saw him scrubbing floors at Camp Hale and said, "Hey, aren't you Paul Petzold?" He was well known as the, you know, the American, the man who climbed higher than anybody else. So they put him to work working on rope evacuation, litter evacuation, that kind of thing. And I don't think he went to Italy, but after the war, Petzold and his friend Tap Tapley here, both were very active in the Colorado Outward Bound School at first. And then Petzold started the National Outdoor Leadership School in Wyoming that sought to take people out, take youths out into the woods and teach them how to operate in the, for 30 days at a time in the backcountry, and sort of the same kind of thing that he was doing at Camp Hale, I imagine. Tapley was also a 10th guy, kind of a you know, one quarter Passamaquoddy ancestry. People thought he was a, you know, quite the outdoorsman. Here's Bob Morrill from North Conway, or from Conway, New Hampshire, and you can tell he's on his note home, he's described exactly what everything he's carrying at Camp Hale is. But Bob Morrill came back, got married, and started an amusement park in the North Conway area called Storyland that's still thriving today. So they did, a lot of people did a lot of things. Friedel Pfeiffer here in MTG actually on one of their trips came down and walked through Aspen and realized what a great venue Aspen would be for a ski area. And even before the war was over, had talked with the local ski club about whether, you know, how to form, how to get lifts installed there, and came back after the war and along with a lot of help, particularly from a financier called Walter Papke, did turn it into a ski resort that was kind of struggling in the 1950s, but as you know, it's not anymore. John Litchfield, a lot of the 10th guys ended up in Aspen right after the war. John Litchfield was a Dartmouth grad from Auburn, Maine. He owned the Red Onion bar at the base of the lifts. Here's a shot of Bill Bowerman skiing at Aspen during his 10th training. About 19, he became a track coach at out in the Northwest, and one of the co-founders of the Nike company. He's the guy who came home and used his wife's waffle iron to pour rubber in and create the waffle sole for those early track shoes. Fritz Benedict, again at Aspen, became an architect, was an architect, and designed a lot of the homes around, the expensive high-end homes around Aspen. Herbert Schneider from North Conway went back and ran Cranmore Mountain for pretty much the rest of his life, owned the mountain. Pete Seibert ended up in Aspen for a little while, wounded pretty badly during the war. He'd actually grown up right near North Conway or spent part of his teenage years at this little ski area called Stanton Slopes, right outside of Bartlett Village. And so he'd actually grown up at a ski area, was a pretty good skier. But he, after the war, after working at Loveland Pass for a while, Loveland ski area, found this valley and was actually alerted to it by a guy named Earl Eaton, and this all became Vail. And Pete Seibert was the guy who pretty much assembled the investor group that turned that valley into this. Here he is, Pete Seibert with two other 10th, Bob Parker and Sarge Brown, and they're actually, I don't know if you can see it, they're dedicating a trail to Minnie Dole. So there was a big 10th involvement at Vail. Parker was an editor of a national ski magazine and then became the marketing director at Vail, and Sarge Brown, who'd run the ROTC program at Dartmouth until about 64, came out and was the operations guy. This is Duke Watson during the war on Homestake Peak. After the war, he was one of a bunch of people who got together and scouted out and realized that what's now Crystal Mountain in Washington would make a good ski area. Awesome place if you've ever been there. Again, he wasn't a sole proprietor or discoverer, but Mount Bachelor in Bend, Oregon was started by a 10th man, Bill Healy. I don't think I have a picture of him in here. Thad Thorne trained with the 10th and ended up going to Japan, but started Attitash in Bartlett, New Hampshire. And then there was pretty much right after the war, there was a very strong Veterans Association for the 10th Mountain Division, National Association of the 10th. Here they are dedicating a monument at Tennessee Pass, right above Camp Hale in, I think, 1959. There was something like almost 1,000 killed in action in the war and 4,000 wounded out of there. So a 25% casualty rate for the 10th, and here they are celebrating it. But after the war, they were very active in doing a number of things, like starting the 10th Mountain Division Hut Association. I think Fritz Benedict designed some of those, but there's a chain of 10 or 15 huts in the Colorado Mountains run by the 10th Mountain Division Hut Association. They were instrumental in forming the International Federation of Mountain Soldiers, where they sort of reached out to mountain-trained soldiers all over the world, and you know, these have meetings here and there. This was one that at Jericho, Vermont, a few years ago. And while the current 10th Mountain Division at Fort Drum, New York, exists and is one of the probably the most deployed division since they were reactivated in the early 80s, it's really at Jericho, Vermont, that the old 10th's function of training other infantry troops in the mountain skills takes place. The Army Mountain Warfare School puts on demonstrations like this IMFS thing, but they're the reservoir of experience in the Army in mountain and winter warfare. Here's a picture of Jock Parker, who was one of the people that climbed Riva Ridge, talking with some of these guys from Jericho a few years ago. And the association still gets together at various, they have chapters all over the country. This is the New England chapter, veterans. They have a yearly get together on Mount Washington. This is a couple of years ago. It's a dwindling number, but they're still very active. So I think the last word really goes to Bob Livermore, who, by the way, of the four people that got together in Bromley and discussed the 10th, was the only one to join the 10th and went all the way through with it. So he's writing, well, there it is, a division of men called mountain troops, composed of a few real mountaineers, many amateur mountain men, many good mule packers, many skiers and snowshoers, a great many who had received adequate army training in mountains, but who were at heart flatlanders. There were some who couldn't ski, some who were scared of heights, some couldn't rappel, some couldn't pack a mule, some hated the sight of hills, some loved it, but they were all soldiers and they could all fight. And they were with others who could both fight and climb and lead them through any mountains. And best of all, they were proud as hell as being U.S. mountain troops. So if there are any questions, I'll try to answer them as best I can. Yes, sir.
What was the name of the local man you
were talking about? Wendell Cram.
C-R-A-M.
And his brother, Vernon. Did Vernon go in?
Yes.
Right up here on the table, they have a picture of both of them. I'm sure there were many others from the area.
Bob Warden was right here in Woodstock.
Bob Warden. Okay, right. Right. I mean, they joined up from all these ski towns. I'm sure there were more from the area.
Wendy said he taught a lot of people to ski.
Yeah. In the Army.
A lot of people to ski.
Yeah, because he was a great skier. He made the 1940 Olympic team. Of course, the 1940 Olympics weren't held because of the war. But he was a great skier.
I was surprised that Bradford Washburn didn't get involved in the 10th.
Yeah.
He was training or doing the equipment?
Well, he was training, and then he got involved with I think with aerial photography through the Air Force, which was another one of his big things. So, you know, that Alpine, that whole American Alpine Club group had a lot to do with getting the equipment going. And then some of them joined as well, but not Washburn. He was a little older, you know, at that point.
Be sure to look at the notebook that the Cram family put together over there on the table. There's a lot of references to the 10th Mountain and to their Olympic and training and skiing here. Really nice photographs and nice stories.
Yeah. We definitely had four soldiers from Bridgewater that we know of, and we know other families have told us that, you know, their the Scales, I think, was one of the first inducted at the Stowe. He was also from Bridgewater. So
okay.
We know four or five for sure.
You know, the Denver Public, the 10th Association designated the Denver Public Library as the repository that people should donate their items to. So they have a 10th Mountain Division curator out there. And they've assembled a database of from the Army Morning Reports of who went through the 10th. So if anybody has a relative or, you know, an ancestor that may have been in the 10th, you can email the Denver Public Library. They might charge you something to research it, but you'll get back an email that says what the, you know, where they went at various times, where they joined from. So it's quite a good resource. Well, help yourself to these three issues. The three issues together combine the entire talk, more or less, that I've given, if you're interested. So. Take those in one of our catalog there as well, if you're interested. And
we have a visitor here who brought in a pair of skis. He probably did.
Oh, you want to say anything about them? Or?
Yeah, the 10th Mountain skis always had a hole in the top, your combat skis. And the reason for the hole was if the skier became wounded or killed, they could attach a rope, catch him to his skis, and drag him out. They also would drag equipment on these skis if necessary. So it was a very important part of the skis to have this hole up here in the top. And I'm not sure if they had varying lengths of skis. I've heard some say they didn't have varying lengths for different height guys. They were all issued the same length, which is very tall. You know, this is made for a six-footer.
Yeah, that's your size.
Yeah. And now the Finnish Army didn't broadcast what they did with their skis. A lot of this started from the Finnish Army in the 1939-40 war. They never fought on skis, but they didn't want anybody to know that. They would go into battle and immediately get out of their skis. They wouldn't use the strap on the back, and they had a slight rise in their boot,
right,
which would hook under. They would use this front only. It's very difficult, but they needed to immediately get out of the skis before firing the guns. But they tried to hide that fact, and the Russians were the first to find out. They got exterminated in one battle. They had a huge regiment of highly trained Russians who were taught to fight while on the skis, and you don't want to do that. But the main reason why we did skiing, it would never have worked in a place like Italy. It had to be slow, sloping, hilly terrain, not very steep to use skis in battle. What it did, it built, it was mentally, it was good for mental development to learn to ski and to transport yourself across large expanses of snow. But we never got into the kind of hilly terrain that is up in northern Scandinavia. If we were up there, we would use skis a lot more, but we were in Italy, they were useless basically.
At Camp Hale, there would be times when a group on a detachment on skis and one on snowshoes would have to go to the same place, and almost invariably, you know, up and down and up and down, the final destination, the snowshoers were there first. Yes.
Didn't camouflage play a big role in the Finnish War?
Yes.
The Russians were
yes.
in dark colors and the Finnish were all in white.
Well, I think that's probably right. But also the Finns also, you know, there was only one road apparently where a couple of paved roads where the columns were. But the Finns knew where the logging roads that paralleled them were, so they'd essentially either find or build roads parallel to the main roads, and then, you know, every 2 miles or every mile go in and they called it sausage cutting. They'd break the you know, the column here and do it all the way along the line so small groups could attack. And you're right, I've heard that, but there was a Dartmouth ski team member named Dave Bradley, I think, maybe it was his brother Steve, who went over to after the Finnish war was over, went over and interviewed people, and he drew a picture of the kind of, like you say, there's an upturned toe on their boots, sort of like the Laps used, and there was no, you know, they'd have a leather toe strap, but nothing on the heel, so they could just kick them off.
Yeah.
And the Russians would be using something like what we would use for downhill skiing. So they were really hampered. Well, thanks again for coming out on a hot Father's Day.